Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. In the last couple of segments, we've started talking about equity, the last of our topics. I know, sad, isn't it, that we're almost done? Man, time just flies when you're having fun, doesn't it? Anyway, with our discussion of equity so far, we've discussed why it's important, we've discussed how it's recorded for different kinds of companies, so proprietorships, partnerships, corporations, and then we've done some examples on issuing stock, receiving investments from our equity holders. Now it's time to turn our attention to what happens when we start to give back their money and let them have some of the assets that they've built up in the business. And the first way we're going to talk about giving back funds to the owners is what happens if we give them everything we owe them by buying back their shares. We call it treasury stock, and it's a really important part of the current market. Companies choose to buy back their own stock for a number of reasons. Perhaps the most important of these reasons is for tax purposes. You see, when I pay a dividend as a corporation to my investors, they're taxed on that dividend as if it were part of their normal revenue stream. So it gets the same tax rate as their job. If, however, I buy back their shares, then it becomes what we call a capital gain. I'm selling off a long-term asset, and that's not part of my normal income, that's this separate capital gain instead. And the capital gains rates, at least right now, under US tax law, are less than the tax rates on our normal income. So if I can buy back shares from my investors and give them their money that way, then they get taxed less on this investment. So that's one of the reasons why we may choose to buy back shares, is to do it instead of a dividend and thereby provide our investors with more of their cash because they wanted to pay out a bunch of it in taxes. We might also buy back shares to improve our earnings per share. We might also do it to fulfill stock options. We give managers these options to buy stock at a certain price. So when they come in, we don't want to issue brand new shares because that's kind of a pain with the SEC. So we go out to the market, we buy the shares that we need for them and give them the stock at the price we agreed to. We can use this to stop a hostile takeover. If there's another company trying to buy us out, if we own a bunch of the shares, then we have some votes, we can stop that process. And finally, we can do it to increase the market price. And this last one tends to be the most common of the reasons to buy back stock. You'll often see a new CEO stepping in and saying, I'm going to improve this business so much, the stock price is going to go through the roof, so I'm going to buy a bunch of the shares now because it's going to be such a good investment. And they'll buy a bunch of shares back, and the market will say, oh, that's a good idea then. Let's buy a bunch of stock. And so the stock price will increase because everybody's buying shares. Now, the key concept with treasury stock is that it is not an asset. I don't record this with other stocks and bonds I purchased up in my asset section. I have given money back to my owners, and so I am creating a contra equity. You see, we really have two options when we buy back stock. We can retire them completely, which means we pretend like we've never issued them at all and they go back into our reservoir of unissued shares, or we can hold them as treasury stock. Most companies will keep these shares as treasury shares because it's easier to reissue a treasury share than it is to create a new equity offering to issue shares. So by keeping them as treasury stock, I make it easier for myself to sell them when I need cash again in the future. But because we're giving money back to the owners, I have to reduce my equity for this. So I can't put it into my asset section. I have to put it as a negative or contra equity account. Now, we don't pay dividends to these shares. They're not included in earnings per share because the company owns them instead of real investors. So we can use the treasury stock to stop a hostile takeover. I can reissue them whenever I want to, but it also reduces my dividend obligation and improves my earnings per share, which is one of the reasons I might buy this treasury stock in the first place. What you'll see in the financial statements is you'll see a parenthetical note with our common stock account. So you'll say there's 1 million shares authorized, 500,000 issued, and 450,000 outstanding. And that's the note you'll see on the balance sheet. This is the number that we can legally sell. So we put it in our paperwork when we incorporate. And over the life of our business, we will sell up to 1 million shares. The number here is the number we've actually sold. That's the amount that have been issued. So of the 1 million, 500,000 have been sold so far. I've got another 500,000 that I can issue when I need to generate more capital. The last are the ones that are still out there, owned by my various investors. So if I take the 500,000 minus the 450,000, This is the number of Treasury shares. Because I've issued them, but I bought them back, so they're not part of the shares that are outstanding. You'll see these parenthetical notes all the time. A lot of companies that just haven't bought Treasury shares would say 500,000 shares issued and outstanding, and that's your signal. Oh, no Treasury stock there. They haven't bought any back because everything they've issued is still out there. So just to kind of wrap this up, let's talk about how this shows up on our balance sheet by using a couple of T accounts. So here's our common stock account, and let's say we have $100,000 in that account because we've sold 100,000 shares. And then we buy back our Treasury stock. We buy back 5,000 shares for $10,000. If I net these two accounts, I show that I still have $90,000 net that the owners have invested in my business. They gave me originally $100,000, I gave them back $10,000, so they still have investments of $90,000 in the business, plus whatever their retained earnings are. So these are our basic concepts with Treasury stock, why we do them and how we basically account for them. Again, it's a contra equity. We're showing that our equity holders have less claim on assets because we've paid them back. Now let's talk about the rest of the accounting process for Treasury stock. And it all comes down to one general rule, and that is we keep track of the Treasury stock at what we paid for it. We treat that as its par value, not the real par value that's stated in our legal documents or on the shares of stock, but we pretend that what we paid for these shares is its par value, at least until we resell it. And the reason we do it that way is so we can keep track of whether or not we have a gain or a loss when we resell these shares. If I go back to my old par value, I have no idea when I sell them 10 years from now or 10 months from now or whenever what I paid for them. And now I've lost whether I made money or lost money. If I keep track of them, what I paid for them in the Treasury stock account, then it's easy to see. Oh, I sold 10,000 shares. They cost me $10,000. I got $12,000. Ah, I did a good job. I made $2,000 on these shares. If you keep this principle in mind, then the rest of it becomes really simple. Because when we sell these shares off, it all comes back to this idea that we've kept track of these at what we originally paid for them. So when I sell them off, first thing I do is I credit my Treasury stock for whatever I originally paid for those shares. Next, I debit the cash that I received. The difference? Well, normally I would say it was a gain or a loss, but because this is a transaction with my owner and not a sale from transaction normal business, I can't put it as a gain or loss that hits net income. Instead, it has to stay in equity on the balance sheet. So what I do instead, if there's a gain, I need a credit, then I put that into additional paid in capital, Treasury stock. And that's how I show that I made money. If I lose money, then if I can, I take it out of additional paid in capital, Treasury stock. If I don't have any additional paid in capital, Treasury stock left, if I've taken it down to zero, then the rest has to come out of retained earnings. All right, conceptually, that's how Treasury stock works, but I think it'll all make more sense if we do some journal entries. That and they're just fun to do. So let's do some journal entries on Treasury stock. First off, on April 2nd of year 2, MSR's management team has decided they're going to repurchase 6,000 shares of common stock to try to raise the company's stock price. So we want to do the journal entry for the repurchase if the stock was selling for $35 a share on that day. 6,000 shares, $35 a share, we're going to pay $210,000 for these shares. So I know cash is going out for $210,000. Now, if we were going to retire these shares permanently, I would debit common stock for the par value and additional paid in capital for the rest. But if I intend to hold these as Treasury shares and resell them later without all that fuss with a seasoned equity offering with the SEC, then I put them into this contra equity account and debit it for the $210,000. Repurchased 6,000 shares of common stock at $35 per share. Now, in a lot of the entries we've done over the course of our lectures, we've said that it doesn't really matter what goes into the description, right? We want to provide extra details with debt and some extra details sometimes with adjusting entries, but it really doesn't matter exactly what you put in there. With treasury shares, there are two things that really need to be in this description. The number of shares needs to be here, and the amount you paid per share needs to be in there. We need the price per share so we can treat that as the par value. We need the number of shares so we can keep track as we sell the shares. Did we sell from this repurchase date or that repurchase date, and how many of these are left and how many of those are left? So I just need to be able to know how many shares are involved as I sell them back off later. All right, next, on August 15th of this same year, they had a really great deal, $50 a share. So they're gonna reissue some of those treasury shares because they think it's a good price. So in order to do this, we're gonna start with what we paid for those 1,500 shares. So 1,500, we paid $35 for them. So originally we paid $52,500, and our first step to treasury stock was to credit the treasury stock account for what we originally paid for those shares. The next step was to figure out the cash we get. So 1,500 times 50 is $75,000, and that's my debit to cash. Now, I would love to show this as a gain and show this $22,000 in my income statement and have it make my net income better, but this isn't really a gain because it's money I'm getting from new investors. So I'm going to reduce the contra equity so that my equity as a whole goes up, and I'm going to put the difference into additional paid in capital treasury stock. $22,500. This is to reissue 1,500 shares of T stock from April 2nd, year 2. And the last thing we better put in there is that we issued them at $50 per share. That's how we reissue treasury stock if there's a gain. Now let's take a look at what happens if we don't have a gain or a loss. We just issue for what we paid for these shares. So on August 27th, they need more cash. So they're going to issue a few more of these shares, even though they're not making a profit anymore. They're just going to get out of them what they put into them. So let's see, 2,000 shares, $35 a share is $70,000. So first step is to credit treasury stock for that amount. Then I debit cash. There's no gain or loss to worry about, so I'm done. This is to reissue 2,000 shares of treasury stock from 42 year 2 at 35 per share. So that's what it looks like if we make no profit or loss. We just sell it for whatever we paid for it. It's not a good sign, but at least it's not a bad sign. At least we're saying, yeah, we're still worth at least as much as we originally thought we were worth. Now let's take a look at what happens if we sell for a loss. Now, selling for a loss is a very bad sign. Essentially, what you're saying to the market is, we think our stock price right now is better than it's gonna be for a long time. So we're gonna sell now and get as much as we can out of it before it tanks. Now that might not be the real message. The real message may just be, we're in a cash flow crunch, we need cash now, we'll take whatever we can get, this is easiest, let's do it. What the market is going to see, however, is, ooh, really bad news coming. Well, the rule with reselling at a loss is we use as much of the additional paid in capital treasury stock account to cover the loss as possible. So before we can do much more with this, we need to look at our additional paid in capital. And we had put into this account $22,500. We did that back on August 15th when we sold the first batch of these treasury shares. Now that I know this number, now I can do my journal entry. And we're gonna do it again based on those steps. We're gonna start with what we paid for them. 1,000 shares, $35 a share. So I have to take out of the treasury stock account $35,000 because that's what we put into it. So we've got to take out what we put in. Then we'll figure out how much cash we're getting, and it's not good news. Now we've got this $5,000 difference, and again, if I can, I cover it with what's in this additional paid-in capital treasury stock account. And since I have $22,000 in that account, and I only need $5,000 to break even here, I can do that. Additional paid-in capital treasury stock. And overall, I'm still doing okay with these shares, because I've still overall made a profit, but chances are my market price has just tanked because of the signal I sent to the market. To reissue 1,000 shares of treasury stock from 4-2 year 2 at $30 per share. On November 11th of year 2, the company sold the rest of their shares for $20 a share. So let's see, I started with 6,000. That's what I bought back on April 2nd. I then resold 1,500, that was August 15th. And then I sold another 2,000 on August 27th. And then because of a cash crunch, I sold another 1,000 on September 28th. So I have 1,500 shares left. So let's go through the same process we've been using. 1,500 times $35 is $52,500. And that has to come out of our treasury stock account. Then I need to know how much cash I'm getting. So 1,500 times 20 is 30,000. So I'll debit cash for 30,000. And we have a big difference between these two. 52,500 minus 30,000. We're going to take a hit here of 22,500. Now, if you remember our T account, we don't have that much in our additional paid-in capital treasury stock account. Let's take a quick look. We've only got $17,500 there. So that's the most I can take out of it. We cannot take this account to a debit. We can only take it to zero. So additional paid-in capital treasury stock can only go up to $17,500. Well, I still have to cover another $5,000. And I can't take it out of common stock, and I can't take it out of additional paid in capital common stock, because those shares really are out there now. So the only equity account left to me is retained earnings. So I reissued final 1,500 shares of treasury stock from 4-2. Year two at $20. Hopefully you're feeling comfortable now with treasury stock. Again, most of this process comes down to remembering I take out of the treasury stock account what I put into it when I bought the shares. And then I do the cash, and then I use additional paid-in capital and sometimes retained earnings to keep track of any difference. Now, let's take just a second and talk about the IFRS rules for treasury stock. We do have to make sure that everything is recorded directly to equity, just like we do with US GAAP, but under IFRS, we have some flexibility about where we put them. You can keep them in a treasury stock account if you want to, but they really recommend you either take it out of share capital, which means that you reduce what we call our common stock account, or you take it out of share premium, additional paid-in capital, or you take it directly out of retained earnings. So you can do treasury stock, or, like I said, recommended, you actually take it out of one of these existing equity accounts. Now, they do require that the details be included somewhere. So if you don't put it in treasury stock on the balance sheet, in those parenthetical notes, etc., then you do have to have a footnote describing what's going on with your treasury stock. We've done some fun journal entries in this segment, but it's time to wrap up our discussion of treasury stock, because we need to move on and start talking about preferred stock and how it's a little bit different than common stock. We'll do that in our next segment. I'll see you then.